rejoice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and His love.
When the world seems cold and your friends seem few, there is someone who cares for you. When you've tears in your eyes, your heart bleeds inside, there's someone who cares for you. Someone to care, someone to share all your troubles like no other. Wash the tears from your eyes, you're His child, and He cares for you. When disappointments come, and you feel so blue, there's someone who cares. You need a friend till the end. There's someone who's a friend to you. Someone to care, someone to share all your troubles like no other. The tears from your eyes, you're His child, and He cares for you. Someone to care, someone to share all your troubles like no other. Tears from your eyes, you're His child, and He cares for you.
Saved by the blood of the crucified one, now ransomed from sin and a new work begun. Sing praise to the Father and praise to the Son. Saved by the blood of the crucified one. Saved. suppose God searched through heaven and couldn't find one willing to be the supreme sacrifice that was needed, that would buy eternal life for you and me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul so glad he was willing to drink his bitter cup. Although he prayed, "Father, let it pass from me." Oh, I'm so glad he didn't call heaven's angels. From my hands pull the nails that torment me. Had it not been for a place called Mount Calvary, had it not been for the old rugged cross, had it not been for a man called Jesus, then forever my soul
Hebrews chapter 4. I simply want to talk to you about the power of God's Word. The power of God's Word. There's great power in the Word of God, and the Scripture is very clear about that. It's a powerful book. This principle is illustrated by a true story, which was told by Dr. Howard Pope. He tells of a beautiful young lady who once read a book and came to him declaring it to be the most boring book she had ever read in her life. She said, if I ever meet the author, I would ask him why he wrote such a worthless tome, and a tome is a huge book that would put you to sleep in no time. Soon after that experience, the young girl fell in love with a brilliant Christian man. One night as they were talking together, the young man saw the worthless book sitting on the coffee table and said to the young lady, "Have you read this book?" And she said, "Yes, I have." And shyly, the young man said, "The reason I ask is because I wrote it." she was stunned. She picked it up again and looked at the name of the author, and it was the same name as this guy. It just shocked her. So that night, the girl stayed up all night rereading the book, because now she had fallen in love with the author. Now she wanted to know everything about the one who she loved. When she finished the book a second time, she was sure this man would be her husband. When the young man visited her a few days later, she said, "I read your book again. And I think it's wonderful, it's brilliant, it's the best book I've ever read in my life." The difference is she knew the author. King David said it this way, "Thy word is very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it." He loved the book. He loved the word of God. And there's something about knowing the author of the book that changes your whole perspective when you read the Bible. And before you become a Christian, you know, it's drudgery. You know, everybody tells you you should read the Bible, and you pick it up and you go to sleep after the first verse, you know, because you don't know the author. But once you know the author and you know he's going to talk to you through the book, all of a sudden, this is how you get acquainted with God. What's God want for my life? How does he want to guide me? And how does he protect me? How does he sustain me? I want to know all of this. And so you get into the Bible, and it brings you closer and closer to the author of the book. And so today I want us to see four reasons why we should respect the power of the Word of God. In this verse, it's a very simple verse. Our children memorize this early in life, and it's a good one to memorize. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll open our hearts today to the word of God. Help us to appreciate it and also the power that it affords us. In Christ's name we pray, amen. The Bible, which is the Word of God, is unlike any book you and I have in our homes or that's in any library of the world. It is unique. It is totally different. There is only one Word of God, okay? Totally different than any other book that's ever been written. The Library of Congress lays claim to being the largest library in the world, with more than 130 million items on approximately 530 miles of shelves. That's a long distance. The collection includes more than 29 million books and other printed material, 2.7 million recordings, 12 million photographs, 4.8 million maps, and 58 million manuscripts. That's just in the Library of Congress. Yet among all these volumes, the only one that can lay claim to being alive and powerful is the Word of God. Notice what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, "For the Word of God is quick." What it's saying is the Word of God is alive. And you might say, alive? How can the Word of God be alive? Because Jesus is the Word. He has always been the Word. He was the Word before he came into this world and was manifest in the flesh, and he took on the name of Jesus. But before then, he was called the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made flesh, dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. And so he was the Word with God. He is God. And so he's alive. Thus, the Word of God is alive. This places the Bible in a unique category all to itself. The Word of God is living, because it cannot fail to be living, because Jesus Christ is living. It's eternal. Jesus is eternal. The Word of God is eternal. Evangelist Gypsy Smith told of a man who said he had received no inspiration from the Bible although he had gone through it several times. Gypsy Smith said to the man, "Let it go through you once, then you'll tell a different story." It's one thing for us to read the Bible and go through the Bible. It's another thing to let the Bible go through us. Big difference. It's alive. What's that mean? It means that it can adapt to us and our situations and circumstances to life. When you're hurting, it can comfort you. When you've sinned, it can convict you. When you're depressed, it can give you hope. When you're down, it brings you joy. When people have turned against you, it can encourage you. There's just something about the Word of God that fits your situation. It used to be when I was young, you know, I never read the Psalms. When I got old, I needed encouragement. I needed something to pick me up. And boy, I start reading the Psalms now. It talks about, hey, when you're going through struggles and trials and problems like David did, God's with you. And man, you sit there and you start looking at how God sustained David and the great promises of God and how it encourages you, because that's what you're going through at the time. And you go to other portions of Scripture where you're doing without and you have nothing, and then you read great portions of Scripture where my God shall sustain you. He'll meet your every need, and it comforts you. The Word of God is alive. No other book in the world is alive. And it's a wonderful book. In 2 Corinthians 1:20, the Bible says, "For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen." What's that mean? It means they're yes, they come true through Jesus Christ. In other words, every promise made in the Bible is affirmed and is positive through Jesus Christ our Lord. It's wonderful to know that God doesn't lie. I'm glad I can read the Bible and know that God doesn't lie to me. I mean, if you're like me, you look around at life, every product promises to be the best, doesn't it? We're number one. Well, how can there be more than number one? I thought it was number one. I thought there was only one number one. But every product is number one. Every product is the best. Well, they can't all be the best. So somebody's not telling me the truth. It's either the best or it's not the best. But everybody says that and they proclaim that. So as a result, you're confused. You don't know what to believe. It's like the government. They twist numbers to convince you that you're doing great. They can tax us more and I'm supposed to feel good about it. I mean, I watched the news the other day and they was talking about the unemployment figures. 6.7. And that's the unemployment. Well, those are the ones that some have just dropped out of the workforce. They're not even looking for a job. We don't count those. We're the only government, I think, that if you follow that rationing, every unemployed person that would stop looking for employment, the government would say, in America, we have 100% employment because you got millions that quit looking for work. And so I'm just simply saying, no matter where you look, people twist things. They don't tell you the truth. You don't know whether you're getting the truth or not. Friends will tell you they'll be there for you until you really need them. And then all of a sudden, where are they? I don't see them. I'm glad God's word is true. He's always true. The promises of God are yes. You can count on it. You can go to the bank on the promises of God. Man, I tell you what, there's such security in that. Now, the Word of God is alive, and secondly, the Word of God is powerful. The Word of God is quick, the Bible says, and powerful. Now, the word translated powerful is the word from which we get energy or energetic. The word literally means at work. The Word of God is at work. Now, I understand that I open this Bible and it's just print. It's just regular paper and there's just regular ink on that page. All right, just same ink that they printed another book with. Same paper that's in another book. The only difference about it is the words. The words are organized to make a statement, and that statement came from God. It's God's word. And it's God speaking to us, and because it's God's word and it's alive, it's powerful. It's powerful. Charles Swindoll made this comment. He says, news articles may inform us. Novels may inspire us. Poetry may enrapture us. But only the living, active Word of God can transform us. How can the Word of God change me? Because it's powerful. It's powerful. You read a book, it inspires you. Okay, you feel good about it for a little bit. Something else does inform you. You go to the dictionary, you read things or the encyclopedia, and it informs you. But the Word of God literally can transform you and change you. That's what's wonderful about the Word of God. One of the great results of reading the Bible is the change that it will bring into our lives if we will allow it to do that. The Holy Spirit blesses the words of this Bible and empowers it to turn a wretched sinner into a righteous saint. It's remarkable. There's all kinds of programs, self-improvement programs, but there's nothing like the Bible. It literally takes a corrupt individual who can be wicked, more wicked than you can imagine, and literally change that person and make a good person out of that person. Because it's powerful. The Word of God is powerful. Isaiah, the old prophet of old, in Isaiah 55:11, said this about the Word of God. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. He's speaking on behalf of God. So shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. And so God says, if we give out the Word of God, God will take care of it doing its work. It's one of the nice things about a preacher. I don't have to try to convince anybody anything. I have a responsibility to preach the Word of God accurately. And I preach it passionately because I believe in it. And God says, if I will get up and deliver the Word of God honestly and accurately, just like it is in the Bible, God says, I will bless it. It will not return unto me void. It will reach out and touch people's hearts and lives. I remember when it touched my life. I didn't go to church looking for God. He came looking for me. And I heard the Word of God preached, man, and all of a sudden, this verse became alive in my life. I mean, it cut me. I mean, it dug deep into my heart. It was powerful. It convicted me of my sins. I saw how short I came from the glory of God, and I needed Christ. How's that possible? It wasn't the preacher up there just selling me something. It wasn't just because he had charisma. It was because the Word of God was alive and working in my life to change me. And many of you know exactly what I'm talking about. That's what the Word of God does. One of the most dramatic examples of the Bible's divinely inspired ability to transform men and women was seen in that I think there was a film out, and there's a book called Mutiny on the Bounty. Many of you remember that. You've heard of it. Following the rebellion against the notorious Captain Bligh, 9 mutineers, along with the Tahitian men and women who accompanied them, found their way to the Pitcairn Islands, a tiny dot in the South Pacific, only 2 miles long and a mile wide. 10 years later, alcohol, fighting, had left only 2 men alive, John Adams and Ned Young. And you can look this up on Wikipedia. They 11 women and 23 children made up the rest of the island's population, along with John Adams and Ned Young and the few that was on the bounty. So far, this is a familiar story made famous in the book and motion picture, Mutiny on the Bounty. Now, as Paul Harvey used to say, the rest of the story. About the same time, John Adams, came across the Bounty's Bible. There was a Bible that they had in that ship. It was in the bottom of an old chest. And while he was on the island, he was going through the chest and he found the old Bible. Now, John Adams was a wicked man. He and Young began to read it. And the divine power of God's word reached into their hardened evil hearts. There on that little tiny volcanic speck in the vast Pacific Ocean. And God changed their lives. Out of no man's land. Handful of people. No environmental influences except one. The Bible. Young eventually died of an asthmatic infection, but Adams continued on. The peace and love that Adams found in the Bible and in Jesus Christ entirely replaced the old life of quarreling and brawling and liquor and all that went with his riotous living. It literally transformed him. He began to teach the children from the Bible, until every person on the island had experienced the same amazing change that he had found in Christ. Today, with a population of less than 100, nearly every person on the Caron Island is a Christian. How's that possible? Because the Bible is alive and it's powerful. It not only changed their lives, it's changed my lives, it's changed many of your lives, and if you're here without Christ, and you're looking for a better life, you're looking for a home in heaven, it'll change your life if you let it. I mean, this is what we have. This is the product that God has given to us to take to the world to change people's lives. Because it's alive and it's powerful. The power of God's word changed old John Adams. Just as it changed the Apostle Paul when he was Saul. Took him from being the chiefest of the sinners to maybe the leader of the saints. Isn't it wonderful how God can change us just through reading this book? It's because God blesses it. God blesses the reading of His Word. What God's done in the lives of these men and many of us that are here today, He's still doing in other people's lives as well. It's wonderful to see people's lives change for the glory of God. And that's why it's important that we give them the Bible. I've got this blessed old King James Bible in my hand. It's worked for a lot of years and it's going to continue to work. Amen? Amen. The Word of God is not also, it's penetrating. The Bible says in verse 12, the Word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. Piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow. So what the author is saying is that God's word can reach into the innermost recesses of our being. No heart's too tough, no soul's too dark, that it cannot be changed for the glory of God. When God wills it, His word can pierce anyone. Just as certain as it pierced Mr. Thorpe's in the 18th century in Bristol, England. You see, Thorpe was a part of a band of men who called themselves the Hellfire Club. Oh, that was a mockery name. Their reason for existence was simply to mock and ridicule the work of the famed evangelist George Whitefield. And so they took on that name, the Hellfire Club, just simply as a a form of mockery because George Whitefield would go out and preach hellfire and brimstone. And so in mocking him, we became the Hellfire Club. On one occasion, the Hellfire Club gathered at a pub simply to mock George Whitefield. Mr. Thorpe offered his brilliant imitation of Whitefield, whom he and his friends called Mr. Squintum because of Whitefield's eyes. Mr. Whitefield would squint. And so Tharp, in mocking him, would say, "I'm Mr. Squintum." Oh, they had fun at the mercy of George Whitefield. Mr. Tharp delivered his sermon with brilliant accuracy, again mocking Whitefield, perfectly imitating his tone and facial expressions as he quoted scripture and mocking Whitefield's remarks. But something happened. Suddenly, amidst the laughter, while he's doing this, he had to sit down. He was pierced through. He came under tremendous conviction. And he was converted on the spot. After quoting the very scriptures that George Whitefield, and he's quoting them in mockery, the very scriptures that he quoted convicted him. And people said that something just happened to him. He just started changing. He had to sit down. And history records that he gave his life to Christ at that moment. Mr. Thorpe was, like I said, he was a very wicked man, engaged in many wicked actions, according to Charles Spurgeon. Yet the Word of God pierced his heart and changed him in an instant. Mr. Thorpe went on to be a prominent Christian leader in the city of Bristol. How could that be? Because we have a Word of God that's powerful, and it reaches right into the very recesses of our heart that nothing else can reach. It's penetrating. It was the Word of God that pierced the hearts of those who brought the woman caught in adultery. Recall that. We're studying that on Sunday nights when Jesus wrote in the dirt and said to those who sought to condemn the woman, he said, "He that is without sin, let him first cast the stone at her." And the Bible says, being convicted by their own conscience, they went out one by one. The Word of God, it's able to do what no man can do. Thank God for the Bible. It's the tool. If you want to win your loved ones to Christ, give them the Word of God. God's Word will not return unto him void. And the Word of God continues to this day in bringing people face to face with their sinful lifestyle. I've had people tell me, "Well, my sin's too great." Let me explain to you that God came to save sinners. He says, "I didn't come to call the righteous." I love that verse of Scripture. He says, "I didn't come to call the righteous to repentance. I came to call sinners to repentance." What's he talking about? He's saying those who think they're good enough to go to heaven, they're the toughest to win. Those who know they're a sinner and say, "I've committed this and committed that and committed this, and I don't feel worthy of God's grace," those are the very ones that Christ came to save. So don't run from the fact that you're guilty. Say, "God, I know I'm guilty." And God's Word will come down and lovingly touch your heart. Aren't you glad for God's grace and his mercy? And so the Word of God shows us our sin. It shows how short we've fallen from God and how God loves us and will save us if we give our lives to him. Fourthly, the Word of God is discerning. Verse 12, "And it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Verse 13, "There is Neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto his eye, unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. Now, a discerner, it says he's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. What's he mean by that? A discerner means that God's word is skillful in judging our real intentions. Now, see, you and I, we can't tell people's intentions. You know, we think they really care for us, but they may have a whole different intention. But God's word is able to go to the very intent of that person. Let me close with these two final thoughts. The Bible implies in verse 13 that God sees everything. Neither is there any creature that's not manifest in his sight. All things are naked and open unto his eyes. God sees everything. There's just simply no hiding from God. Only the Word of God is capable of exposing the thoughts and attitudes of a single human heart. Only God's Word. It's able to go where no one else can see. And he will do that. How many times have I preached a sermon, somebody come up and said, Preacher, did somebody talk to you about me? Man, you got all over me today. Did somebody tell you my secrets? No, that's the Word of God. It has the ability to go deeper than we want it to go. It goes to the very intents of our being and our thought patterns. It knows our intentions. What it's really saying is there's no hiding from it. That's why some people don't like going to church. Because they know, hey, that thing, I'm liable to get convicted. Well, that's good. I wouldn't, but I'll be honest with you. I'm going to chase a rabbit here. I wouldn't go to a church that didn't preach something that convicted me. I don't want to go someplace where somebody tells me, you're okay, everything's okay, you're wonderful, God bless you. I know better. God knows better. I'm not okay. I'm not just wonderful. And that's what the Word of God is for. It's to reprove me. The Bible is clear about that. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God for reproof, for correction. It is to correct me spiritually. For instruction in righteousness. It's supposed to show me how I should live to please God. And that's what it's to do. And so, you know, occasionally it's all right to let the preacher get on your toes. Why? Because God's saying, lovingly trying to say, hey, I want to change you in this area. I'll make you a better person. Because God sees who I am. I can't hide from him. The Bible says all things are naked or literally laid bare before God. With God, we cannot smooth over with outward actions the real intentions of our hearts. The Pharisees tried to do this. They wore all the right clothes. You know, they would go out on the sidewalks and make long prayers. I mean, they played the part really well. I mean, everybody looked at them and said, these are religious and righteous people. But God says, you're not. Why? Because the Word goes to the very person that we are. Again, that's why God had more success with the down and outer than he did the up and outer. The down and outer understands, hey, I know what I am. And God says, I can help you. The self-righteous person over here says, I think I'm okay. I don't think I need any help. God says, probably can't help you at all because you don't need any help. You don't even think you need help. But there will be a day you're going to realize you should have accepted the help. And so that's why Jesus, the Bible says, the common people heard him gladly, because they knew they had problems. And the Word of God spoke to them. And that's exactly what it'll do. And so we may appear to be sincere to others, but God knows if we have an ulterior motive. There's just no hiding from Him. Why? Because the Word of God is discerning. It's skillful in judging our real intentions. And then secondly, God sees everything, so there's no excuses. The last part of that verse in 13 says, all things are open unto the eyes of Him with whom we have to do. What's that mean? It means to the one that we must give an account someday. In other words, everything about me is open to the Lord, and one day when I give an account to God, He sees it all. Nothing's hidden before Him. That's why we're better off not to try to hide from God, because God sees us anyway. Amen? We might as well just fess up and say, God, I'm a sorry speck. God, I don't even know why you even fool with me. God says, I love you. I love you. That's why. I'm unworthy of your love. And God says, that's all right. I love you anyway. God, is there any hope for me? Absolutely, there's hope for you. And the hope is in Jesus Christ. I love that song. It says, God, look beyond my faults, but He saw my need. He knew what I could be, not what I am in myself. I'm nothing in myself. It's only what Christ can do through me, and the person that He can make me is anything that's good to God. And so once we understand that, God, I can't hide a thing from You, the Word of God convicts me and it speaks to me, and I'm going to stop running from it. I'm just going to submit to You and allow the goodness of God to flow through me. God says, that's what I want. I want the love of Christ to flow through to you, to other people, that they might see my Son in you. Because we will give an account of our lives to the Lord. The day of excuses will be over. The book of Romans tells us that there's coming a time when every mouth will be stopped. Romans 3:19. No more excuses. And so, how can you excuse it when God sees you anyway? It's like getting your finger caught in a cookie bowl. I've had my hand slapped many a time because it was in the cookie bowl. Samuel Chadwick, many years ago, wrote this about the Bible. He says, I've guided my life by the Bible for more than 60 years. And I'll tell you, there's no book like it. It's a miracle of literature. It's a perennial spring of wisdom, a wonder of surprises, a revelation of mystery, an infallible guide of conduct, and an unspeakable source of comfort. Pay no attention to people who discredit it, for I tell you that they speak without knowledge. It is the Word of God itself. Study it according to its own direction. Live by its principles, believe its message, follow its precepts. Then he concludes by saying this, no man is uneducated who knows the Bible, and no one is wise who is ignorant of its teaching. That's why I often say the best thing our school systems could do is put the Bible back into it. You want to teach your kids to be smart? Give them the Bible. Foolish is the person who doesn't know the Bible. I don't care how many facts they have. I don't care how educated with formulas that they have. They cannot make proper and wise decisions without the Word of God. Gives them the wisdom from Almighty God. And we sit and we watch in our culture and society today, people with the highest degrees in education making the most foolish decisions. And you and I sit back and scratch our head and say, how in the world could they do that? You know what I'm talking about. You do that. They come out with a new this and a new that and a new this and say, what's wrong with those people? How can they go to Harvard and Yale and Princeton? And how can these people get such degrees and yet make such foolish choices and decisions? They don't know the Word of God. Nor do they know the God of the Word, all right? The Word of God is powerful. We need to respect the fact that we have the powerful Word of God in our hands today, and it's able to change lives, help us to make the wise and rich decisions that we need in this land. The best thing America could do is get back to the Bible. Amen? Stand with me, please.
Who's gonna carry the light? Tell me who's gonna keep it shining bright all through the night until home is in sight. Who's gonna carry the light? Who's gonna carry the light? Tell me who's gonna keep it shining bright.
The wind and the sea to obey. On behalf of Moses, he parted the water, and they walked across on dry land that day. He was Abraham's ram, Noah's rainbow, the rod of Aaron that sprung to life. He was the mantle of Elijah, God Jehovah Jireh. Whatever you need, I know the Lord.
The bonds of prison for me. some of these
days I'm going home,
where no
sorrows ever come.
We'll soon be done.
We'll soon be done with troubles and trials.
Safe from
heartache, pain, or care,
we shall
all that glory share.
Then I'm going
to sit down beside of my Jesus. Sit down and rest a little while. We'll soon be done with troubles and trials.
Troubles and trials in that home.
Yes, in that home on the other side.
On the other side.
Shake glad hands with the elders.
And I'll
tell my kindred good morning.
Then I'm gonna
sit down beside of my Jesus. Sit down and rest a little while.
Well, I shall be.
Hold his blessed face. Feel his matchless grace.
We'll soon be done.
We'll soon be done with troubles and trials.
Oh, what
peace and joy sublime
in that
home of love divine.
Then I'm going
to sit down beside of my Jesus. Sit down and rest a little while. We'll soon be done with troubles and trials.
Troubles and trials in that home.
Yes, in that home on the other side.
On the other side.
Shake glad hands with the elders.
And I'll
tell my kindred good morning.
Then I'm gonna
sit down beside of my Jesus. Sit down and rest a little while. We'll soon be done with troubles and trials.
Troubles and trials in my home.
Yes, in that home on the other side.
On the other side.
That day with the chosen ones there at his side. You see, he came upon a man who was blind from birth. He was accused to be bound in sin's ways. Oh, but Jesus the Master had compassion on him, and the blind man would never be the same. For just a touch from the Master and a small piece of clay, those blinded eyes, they see the light of day.
When the Master walks by, sin is defeated, healing can come
through
faith in the Son. Simple lives can be changed through the power in Jesus.
In my life, I was so deep in sin, no one cared if I lived or I died. You see, I was broken, I was defeated, in need of a change. Then Jesus, thank God, he showed up on the scene. And then at an altar of repentance I knelt, and my life, it's never been the same. For it was there Jesus touched me and he forgave all my sin. Now forever I'm gonna live for him. Amen.
And when the Master walks by,
oh, he walks by.
Can be changed through the power in Jesus.
your life will be changed
when the Master walks by.
When the Master walks by.
Got down on my knees and I prayed, dear Lord, I know I'm not worthy of the price you pay for me. But I know there must be mercy, cause you stayed upon the tree.
There was a whole lot of mercy. There was a whole lot of grace. There was a whole lot of love in the blood that was streaming down his face. He took the nails and the thorns and the agony and he died. There was a whole lot of mercy. There was a whole lot of grace.
Ooh, yeah, how many knows what I'm talking about tonight?
In the middle of a trial that you're facing in your life, you can't seem to bear. You just give it all to Jesus and I know he's gonna meet you there. Pray, dear Lord, I know I'm not worthy.
There was a whole lot of grace.
There was a whole lot of mercy.
There was a whole lot of grace. There was a whole lot of love in the blood that was streaming down his face. He took the nails and the thorns and the agony and he died in my place. There was a whole lot of mercy. There was a whole lot of grace.
You got a whole lot of mercy.
You got a whole lot of grace.
But the things he saw, the Revelator's name was John.
Talk about John.
John the Revelator saw Jerusalem coming down.
He said it was John.
John the Revelator. And when he looked around, he saw feet like grass, eyes like fire. Heard a great voice say, come up higher. John the Revelator wrote about the city of God.
About John.
John the Revelator saw Jerusalem coming down.
Said it was John.
John the Revelator. And when he looked around, he
saw feet like grass, eyes like fire, heard a great voice say, come up higher. John the Revelator wrote about the city of God.
About John.